Welcome to this Microsoft Virtual Academy session about workflow basics with System Center 2012 SP1 Orchestrator. My name is Andreas Reins. I'm a data center architect within the Worldwide Center of Excellence for Private Cloud and Data Center. And today I would like to talk a little bit about the concepts and decision processes that are related to workflow design. So the things that you have to think of before you start creating your workflows using Orchestrator, and also to understand the foundation objects that are there helps you driving the execution of your workflows. So those are the main topics for today. So the agenda for today is we will covering the following topics. So first of all, I would like to talk a little bit about constructing runbooks. What are the things that you have to worry about? Then I will cover guidelines and some tips about how to build workflows. And then we will start digging into the execution of runbooks, how that works. We will again talk a little bit about the runbook server, and then we are going to cover engine rules, and that's quite important topic to cover. And after that, we will talk a little bit about the logs and audit trail and how to troubleshoot Orchestrator if there are any problems. So with planning and design of workflow, first of all, you have to identify your process that you want to automate. So you have to really plan your runbook, and you should really have a defined process that you want to implement with Orchestrator. So, and there are a couple of things that you have to think of. So first of all, how often is that runbook going to run, and when does it run, and how many steps are within that runbook? Which activities can help you implementing that runbook, and a couple of other things that you have to plan and design before really starting working with Orchestrator. And then, of course, you have to map that process in the designer. So for those of you who have listened to the other two sessions that we already did, we covered the Orchestrator designer. That's actually the tool where you build the runbooks with Orchestrator, and there you have to really define how your runbook is going to look like. So and again, think of how often will this runbook run, when will it run, which are the activities you're going to need to really implement that process that's currently a manual process, for example, in your data center, and of course, which data is required to make that runbook work, and what are the results that you want to provide with your runbook. And then, of course, you have to verify the logic and test it. So what you do while building a workflow is really creating a new runbook within the runbook designer. Then you're able to add activities. There might be scripts involved, but you might go ahead with just the out-of-the-box activities. You might using integration pack activities. And then you have to link those activities together using those smart links and arrows to really build the flow and the process together. And then, of course, you have to configure a couple of activity properties using the data bus, for example, using variables, using schedules. And then you have to check in the runbook and test it, and then of course you're able to start your runbook using the runbook designer or go ahead and using the Orchestrator console to start your runbook. So a couple of guidelines how to build your runbooks. One thing you have in the runbook designer on the very left side, you have a folder structure which is very familiar with the Windows Explorer. So you're able to organize your runbooks in folders. And of course, you are able to name those runbooks and also add numbers to that. So if your runbook or the process that you want to automate consists of more than just one runbook, you might use numbers to identify which runbook is starting first and coming next and so on, so that you're able to really understand the logic behind the different runbooks. So from a runbook usage perspective, there's a concept of checking in and checking out your runbook. So as soon as you want to start or edit an existing runbook or start a new runbook, you have to check out that specific runbook. So then you can go ahead and edit and create that runbook. And as soon as you're done with that, you're able to check in the runbook. And as soon as your runbook is checked in, it's able to run on your runbook servers. So with every check-in and check-out, you can write some comments. You have the option to start and stop that runbook within the designer or even using the test tool. And of course, you are also able to use the orchestrator console to start and stop your runbooks. One interesting and very important thing is to think about failure handling. So some logic around what happens if an error occurs in your runbooks, and that's pretty important to have one central way how to handle errors within your runbook. And one good thing is to using colored links. So you're able to color the links you're going to use that you're able to see without any digging deeper to see which part of the runbook is for error handling. So you're able to color those links and you're able to use labels for that. And of course, another important concept is using splitting runbooks. So whenever you think of a specific process that you might use more than just one time, think of using a separate runbook and use that runbook in all the others' runbooks as child runbooks. So, for example, if you want to, error handling is actually a very good example for that. So if you think about some generic error handling where you are accepting some parameters like the error code and some error text, and then create, for example, an incident within Service Manager, you're able to really do that in one runbook and then use that runbook in all your other runbooks to make error handling happening in a very consistent way in all your runbooks. So that's all about how to split runbooks. So I think that's also a very important concept to think about before starting creating your runbooks. And of course, you you're able to use logging. So either within Orchestrator and also externally, that helps you to find out the status and to troubleshoot problems with your runbooks. So from a runbook execution perspective, from the designer, you design your runbooks there. Those will go through the management service to the database, to the data store, the orchestrator SQL Server database, and the runbook servers grab those data, the runbooks, into the runbook server and execute them there, and also update the status back to the data store. So whenever a runbook server runs an instance of one of your runbooks, it will pass back information to the data store about the status. And the console, which you see on the left side, will grab that data from the data store and make it visible to you in the console so that you're able to see real-time information about all the instances of your runbooks. So again, the runbook server is that service that runs your runbooks, and it will communicate with the data store. So even if the management server is not available, the runbook server really communicates directly to the data store. And there are two ways to deploy runbook servers. So first of all, and the first choice is using the deployment manager. That's a tool that's part of System Center 2012 Orchestrator, and you're able to deploy the runbook servers with that tool. And another way is to do a manual install using MSI package. So the deployment manager is not only there for deploying the runbook servers, but you're also using that deployment manager to deploy integration packs, for example. So whenever your runbook is using a specific integration pack, you have to deploy that integration pack to your runbook servers as well. And therefore, Deployment Manager is there to help you doing that. And the runbook servers, again, are communicating with the data store to grab a copy of your runbooks, copy that to the runbook server itself and run it there locally and push back information to the data store about status and so on. So there are a couple of runbook engine rules that I would like to discuss in a little bit more detail. First of all, publish data. So published data really lets you use information from a specific activity in another activity within the same runbook. So, and each activity has a specific set of published data. So whenever an activity runs, after it runs, it publishes that data to the data bus. The next activity is able to use that data. And all activities are also publishing a common set of data items like the start and stop time of the activity and the completion status. So that's common for all the activities. And then, of course, you have a specific set of data items for each activity that's different. And also link condition are also using publishing data to add filtering and decision-making capabilities to runbook. So that's all about published data. Another engine rule is multi-value data. So when an activity runs in a runbook, it runs one time for each item of that data that the previous activity produced. So a very good example for that is think about querying a database. So whenever you want to query your SQL Server, for example, and that retrieves 10 rows from your database, those 10 rows will be passed to the next activity, and the next activity will run 10 times. So that's how multi-value data is working in Orchestrator. For that, you have a concept called flatten. I will cover that in a moment. So the next one is links. We have already discussed it a little bit. So links are those errors that connecting the activities in your runbook. And these errors are called links or smart links. And they will help you to decide the flow of your runbook and to decide whether or not to run the next activity. So if you go and double click on those links, you're able, so there will be a window where you're able to enter some filter information. And that's will be used also for branching, which is one of our next engine rules or concepts within Orchestrator. So whenever you want to branch or want to split the path of your runbooks, you have to add multiple links to your activity and just create a new link by just grabbing from your start activity and drag it to the activity to the start of your second path, and you do some branching there. And you can define the filters. You're able to use include and exclude statements using variables and also, of course, accessing the published data on the data bus. And there are filter conditions like equal, contains, start with, and of course, you can define values for that. So, for example, you can monitor a folder and trigger the next activity for both changed and deleted files within that folder. And there you can split your workflow and define different activities for either changed or delete triggers. And, of course, what I mentioned before in the guidance, use links and label within your smart links that will help you really to understand what's going on in your runbook. So another concept is called junction, and that comes hand-in-hand with the branching idea or concept. So a junction activity allows you to wait for multiple branches in a runbook, so to complete. This activity can also publish data from any branch, so that all the activities in that comes after that junction or after that branch are able to consume that data that the junction activity is publishing to the data bus. So if you think of having a couple of branches that do maybe different things at the same time, you want to bring them together, those different branches, and then go ahead with just a single thread where all the other activities will happen. So that's where Junction comes into work. So the flatten concept, I've already mentioned that in the multi-value data. So when you think about that example with a SQL Server where you query a database and you will get back a couple of results, you are able to flatten that. So this invoke the next activity as many times as there are items in the output. So, and if you don't want that, you're able to use the flatten property. That's part of the activity, and you're able to provide a single output for that activity. And there are a couple of different options. You can either separate it with line breaks or separate that with a specific character that you can define, or you're able to use a CSV format as well with that flatten option. Another concept is the data mapping. So the data mapping, you're able to transform existing published data items or variables into new values according to whatever rules you are going to specify. So for example, if you want to convert numeric values to word values, you're able to use that map published data activity to do that. Another concept is looping. So let's say that you want to have a process or activity run several times. So example for that might be checking for a status of a specific service that's running on a remote server, and you want to check if that service is running or not. So, but you want not only to check it once, but check it for a couple of times, let's say five times in within every 10 seconds. So you have to use looping, so you're defining that on the activity, but you can also define that on a runbook level, so not only on activity level, and you can define exit and do not exit conditions, like for example number of attempts or a specific published data or a specific variable. If that's true, you want to exit or you do not want to exit that loop. And with that, you're able to implement things like checking for status for a specific service for five times every 10 seconds. So the last concept I would like to cover is nesting runbooks. So I've already discussed it in our last session, but I would like to do it again. So you're able to start runbooks within a runbook. So you have some sort of parent-child relationship. One example is what I mentioned before is the error handling idea, so that you have specific runbooks in your environment that takes care about the error handling, and then you're able to call that error handling routine or that error handling runbook within all your other runbooks. So that's all about nesting runbooks, and you're able to do that by using the invoke runbook activity, where you're also able to define passing parameters to that runbook and also returning runbooks for, returning parameters or values from that child runbook back to the parent runbook. So how to work with logs within Orchestrator. So every runbook generates a log. So first of all, you have a real-time log where it shows you real-time information about current running runbooks. So when they have started, what are the activities that run currently? And then you also have the same information for historical runbooks. So for every runbook that that run in the past, there is a historical log entry that tells you when that was started, when it ended, the status of that specific instance, and if you double-click on that in the historical log, you will see all the activities and their status as well. So again, there is start and end times, completion status, and that's done on a runbook level and activity level, and also the published data. So you're able to get information about the published data in the logs as well. So those logs are stored in the data store in the SQL database of Orchestrator. So you're able to purge those logs, and you should do that regularly. So you're able to define schedule, and you can do it manual by just clicking in the runbook designer. There is one entry in the menu that tells you to purge the logs, but you should create and define a schedule that this will happen, for example, every day in the night, and only keep the last couple of entries for troubleshooting, but better do that every day, probably during the night, to purge those logs that they don't fill your data store. And there are also trace logs available, so orchestrator is able to create those messages in a trace log. It will, of course, helps you to identify problems with your orchestrator environment. By default, those will only create it for exceptions, but you can define that. So there is a registry, a folder that has a couple of entries like the log folder, log level, a prefix, and how often a new log should be created. And with that, you are able to control the way Orchestrator is creating those trace log messages. And there's actually a runbook audit trail. It's a collection of text log files with information about your runbook interaction with both external tools and systems. So everything will communicate with your orchestrator will be stored in those text log files. So those runbook audit trail is not activated by default. So if you want to activate that or deactivate that, you're able to do that on the command line with that command here on that slide deck. So what information is actually locked in those text log files? First of all, who and what started the runbook? And also configuration data from each object. So that's quite interesting information. But you need to think of when to activate that audit trail, because that will really consume a large amount of disk space. So think twice before you activate it, and don't forget to deactivate it if you're done with that. So with that, we are closing that session. So we have discussed a couple of guidelines for how to construct runbooks. We've discussed quite a bit about some engine rules and how to manipulate a runbook execution with junctions, with looping, how to flatten output, and also how to troubleshoot your orchestrator environment, and how to enable and disable the runbook audit trail, and also what is the difference between historical and runtime log. So thanks for joining today. I want to close with just give you a couple of more information about where to find information around Orchestrator and Microsoft products and technical learnings. So first of all, go to TechNet Evaluation Center. You'll find a couple of free trial versions of Microsoft software at no costs, and there are no feature limits. Then there are also technical trainings available for IT pros on technetmicrosoft.com/globalitchamps, and of course the Microsoft Virtual Academy, which you'll find on microsoftvirtualacademy.com. Thanks for joining today, and see you soon in the next session about Orchestrator.